My name is Bill Mangus. I'm the medical operations manager for the Vector and Dayton Air Show, and I'm responsible for providing medical care at all levels for the people coming to the air show, for the participants and the performers as well. That includes two hospital tents, hospital personnel, as well as fire and EMS crews that help cover the entire event. About 100 rescuers each day.
And are all the staff, are they volunteers, or are they come in as a volunteer and not as the paid staff member from the hospitals?
Yeah, the air show brings everyone on as a volunteer.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
And we have doctors, nurses, ER staff, paramedics, EMTs from several areas.
Yeah. So for, you know, a child to come out here and the parents, what can they bring and what should the signs they should see when they need to get, you know, some help and get to a tent to get, you know, get care for?
It's really the same for adults and children. They both need to wear like light colored, lightweight, loose clothing. Important to wear closed-toed, comfortable shoes. It's not a day that you want to wear high heels or put your kids in brand new shoes. Wearing comfortable shoes will help with blisters and foot injuries. Everybody needs sunscreen, and they need to make sure that they apply that a lot through the day. Sometimes a baseball hat, if the children will wear one, or perhaps the sunglasses, that helps with the eyes. If they notice that maybe the kids, or really a parent even, starts to complain of a headache, stomach pain, nausea, vomiting, they really start to feel more tired than what they should. Those are all red flags that they're starting to get overheated.
Are you aware that when you come through the doors that you could bring a cooler and bring your own water, or you have to purchase it?
I'm not sure. I'm not aware. I'd need Sheila for that. I really can't remember.
Yeah, that's right. But they should just definitely keep hydrated, whether they have to buy it or not.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
And they can start early, and that, you know, it's really important. While with kids, they're unable to care for themselves, so it's really important for the parents to watch them for any signs of dehydration or being overheated. A lot of times, kids, they won't drink, but parents need to offer them, a lot of fluid, but small amounts throughout the day, and that way that will help them keep hydrated without them getting sick. Same with all those snacks. There's a lot of snacks, and it smells so great there that you can eat them just small amounts throughout the day so you don't get sick.
We do recommend that they stay away from caffeinated beverages and try to go with decaffeinated. Water's clearly the best, but if they're going to have something a little bit sweeter, then try to stay away from the caffeine. We encourage families to make sure they're ready to come to the show, and that means everybody takes their medicines like they normally do before they leave, or as they're scheduled to do, and that they pack everything that they're going to need, including, as Heather mentioned, the hats, sunglasses, the sunblock, whatever they're going to need for that day, so that they're ready when they get here. And make sure they plan for frequent breaks. They can, as much as possible, stop, relax, get something to eat or drink.
And I've seen over the years that they even sit underneath some of the static displays, some of the planes that may help, because there's not much shelter out here. So sitting underneath, you know, one of the wings of the planes can even help.
Oh, certainly, certainly. And if there's a breeze, it helps to some extent as well.
Now, if I was to come to the medic tent as a patient, you know, I was severely dehydrated, maybe throwing up, all that, what would you do to get me back on track while I'm there?
So it's very similar to how any emergency department works. We'll get them registered, we'll get them signed in, they'll be seen by a physician and see how they're doing and what their needs are. And sometimes that means we can get them a little water to drink and cool them off, or loosen up their clothing. If they require IV fluids, to get hydrated, then we're going to recommend they go to the hospital. Because that really takes a long time, and there's no guarantee. Very frequently, we'll give two or three bags of IV fluid, and they're still not feeling well.
Yeah.
So instead of rehydrating here, we choose to transport them to a local hospital.
That's where the EMS personnel come in.
So, well, question, if they are transported, then assuming that their insurance will kick in and will take care of the rest. But being taken care of under the tent and getting, you know, fluids in by Gatorade water or whatever, and then they feel better and they can go back to, you know, their tent, is that a fee or does that cost their insurance?
No, there's no fee. That's done on behalf of the air show.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So what do, you know, the kids, if they are playing, running around, and they stub their toe, or unfortunately, if they fall off something, and maybe it looks like they broke their leg, they're basically, what's going to happen?
Really the same as, you know, we get them evaluated. If it's something that is a Band-Aid or just needs cleaned up or something like that, that's pretty easy first aid. We're totally prepared for that. If it's something more major, then again, they'll get transported. There'll be pediatric staff in both tents. So evaluate them, do what we can. If it goes any further, then they'll go be transported to children.
If for unfortunate anything was to happen to, you know, the people that's flying in the show or some of the static display that possibly needs to be transported to a hospital ASAP, would they have one of the medical helicopters that are here take them?
Whether it's a performer or just someone from the community that's attending, the decision to use a helicopter is really based on how critical they are. We'll actually have roughly six or seven ambulances here each day, as well as a MICU. And then helicopters as well. So typically, we're close enough to the metropolitan hospitals. There's not a lot of benefit to flying a patient from here unless they're really, really sick or really, really hurt. So instead, if it's a performer, we'll have a physician go check the performer out and see what their needs are and address it there. And if they need to come to the tent, they will.
Okay. Well, great. I want to come out on Saturday and Sunday and do a part two. And if we can just shoot some coverage of, you know, what you have, what you provide, then that would be awesome. And then we will continue on because I do want to talk more about the new children's hospital wing and really get that out to the community. And we'll do that in the future.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Can I throw something?
You can, please.
So I'm not sure if people realize it or not, but when we put the medical team together, this is Kettering Health, Premier Health, Dayton Children's, MedFlight, CareFlight, and then typically 15 to 20 fire and EMS departments from around the region, not just close, but from across the region that all come out. And so it's a huge collaborative effort to bring medical care to this, to take care of typically about 50 to 55,000 people a day.
We all work together very well. It's like coming back to family every year. Most of the volunteers have volunteered before, so when we come back, you know, we've missed each other,
right.
But all of us get along so well that it's fun for us.
It is. It really is.
It really is fun.
We enjoy taking care of people anyway. This is just a unique setting to be able to do it in.
Well, I know for us media people, for the last 2 days, when I saw someone or even one of the media volunteers, I'm getting hugs. And it's like, I've missed you so much, you know. And some of us have chatted and stayed in touch via, you know, a phone, Facebook, whatever. But this whole week, we all look so forward to doing our jobs, whether, you know, it's medical or, you know, media. And we want to do it, and we do it for free because we love the aviation. We love, you know, the birthplace of aviation, and it all started here with our Wright brothers. And so, yeah, I know how you feel. It's one happy weekend and week as we
it's
prepare.
Hard, but it's fun.
Yes.
It's hard work.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I know we're going to talk throughout the weekend, and it's going to be a great air show.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, we'll look forward to seeing you out there.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Elias is here. Elias, who? Yeah. Wednesday. You've got your license, right?
Yeah, yeah, I got
it. You've got license.
Thank you.
Right there, start bending it over.
You don't want to put it over.
No.
That's pretty. All these colors are pretty. It's a big bike.
This is a good one. It's the new 6000s over there. That's the brand new one this year.
Right over there?
That's the sickest thing I've ever been on. Never. Feels like a little 600.
That's what you want. Oh. I see you guys commuting on me.
Greg's
gonna ride a bike.
Greg's gonna ride. Okay.
In San Francisco, California. But he quit his job at the airline to study under the tutelage of the greatest air show performer, Sean D. Tucker. And right now, Sean, Johnny D's pulling just a great hammerhead for you. What do you guys think of that? Let's make some noise for Johnny D. Snap rolls across the box, tumbling out of that maneuver. Getting his bearings again. He'll go straight into a half Cuban. He's just sky dancing, making it look easy. And now Johnny D is flying for you today, sponsored by his hero, his mentor. Johnny D is living the dream. Also, be sure to watch Sailing Take Flight this weekend with the 35th America's Cup. Cheer on Oracle Team USA. For details, follow Oracle Team USA on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Johnny D is also an IAC aerobatic competition pilot. He's living with passion and hopes to inspire people just as he was inspired at air shows. At just a young age. Beautiful exact movements. Point rolls right across the box here. A 4-point roll straight into a wedge. Only Oracle offers hardware and software engineered to work together. Oracle simplifies IT while delivering extreme performance at the lowest cost. Complete business and technology solutions in the cloud or in your data center only from Oracle. Johnny Deets going right into a wing over maneuver. Flying with just great precision today. This flight today is a testament to following your dreams, and that dreams are true. So put your hands together one final time for Johnny D. What'd you think of that, Rob?
He's an awesome flyer. I watched him fly in Pittsburgh earlier this year. It's great to see him working his way down to what we call that surface level waiver. He's going to be one of the superstars in the next generation, buddy.
You know it.
Thanks, Brandon Hess.
And we'll see you later for Sean D. Tucker.
Looking forward to it, partner. See you in the Oracle Challenger 3. Danny Clisham, what a day. My name is Rob Ryder, and it is good to be back. Danny Clisham, you're on.
Oh, it is a glorious day. We're so happy that it's clear, and we're so happy that you're here and enjoy this outstanding day. And what a lineup we have for you as we get ready to officially open up our show with our national anthem and the American flag under canopy. Part of our featured performers today is a much sought after all-female skydiving team known as the Misty Blues.
Where are they from, Danny?
They are from coast to coast. However, they are based at the Airshow Entertainer Capital of the World,
Ann Arbor, Michigan. Michigan? Wait a minute. We're talking Buckeye country. Go ahead. Tell us about it, man.
Amanda Scheffler is the current team owner and team manager. She is headquartered in Ann Arbor, Michigan. Flying the jump plane today, which is a Cessna 206, is another Ann Arbor resident, longtime jump pilot and jumper himself, Mike Pelzer. Cessna 206 will be the aircraft of choice for both performances for the team. This is a very unique team. They're called the Misty Blues. Their official colors are hot pink and navy blue. They are and have been performing from coast to coast in all of the popular venues, both sporting events and air shows. And they believe, their 10-member team, currently based coast to coast, they believe in this. Example to young people is the key. They are all educated. They all have degrees. They all have licensed professions. Thereby giving example to young kids that, yeah, it's okay to skydive, but you have to have a responsible life. The team, by the way, Rob Ryder, you know this, they've been around for 30 years with several different owners and leaders. Between the team members, there are 16 world official records, 4 national records, 12 state records, and 32 records total. Now, we talked to you about education. Their professions are licensed pipe fitter and welding instructor, financial analyst, math instructor, civil engineer, aerospace engineer, professional farmer.
A farmer, isn't that amazing?
Professional gemologist and jewelry designer, a licensed carpenter, a licensed real estate agent, and a licensed electrical engineer. And again, we'll go back to many of them. All of them, by the way, have a full degree and maintain their profession day in and day out. So they're a great example to young people, young and old alike. In the U.S., actually in North America, Rob, 35,000 active skydivers, of only 12% of those are women. But we're going to see them excel here today. They'll be performing twice. The team leader, Amanda Scheffler, will be opening up the show with a giant 1,800-square-foot American flag. It will fill up the sky. It will be so much bigger than her hot pink and blue canopy as she brings it in. We'll present our national anthem. It'll be circled by our buddies from the Red Line team. They will be emitting their white smoke system as we present our anthem. That is the way we have opened up the show since before World War II. Back in the golden age of barnstorming and back in the golden age of air racing. Opening up in that unique way, in the air, with airplanes, with white smoke, with the American flag, with the anthem under canopy. Rob, that goes back to the 20s and 30s, and people say, why don't you come up with something different? We have found no better way to open our signature events, those are air shows, than that way to honor our country. So we will continue to do it the way our heroes did it, the Barnstormers and the Speed Kings of the 20s and 30s. And you'll get some great photo opportunities today. We have a little bit of a west wind coming up as we look at the main runway coming over our left shoulder. And we'll see the jumper probably leave the Cessna 206 a little bit to our left and drift back into the target area. So in Kokomo, Indiana, and he was rehearsing for a show and rehearsing for competition, and he had a little problem with his rudder pedal. It's cracked, and you know, that's not good. Airplane takes a lot of punishment. So Rob Holland and Philip Steinbaugh got in a two-place airplane with the bad rudder pedal and the good rudder pedal, came over to Ann Arbor with both of those in hand. We all got in a car from the hangar at the Ann Arbor Airport, went to find Amanda at the college, and gave her the project. Well, she didn't just weld it up. First, she selected material. Then they analyzed the material. Then she got her colleagues involved. Then they heat treated the material. Then they fabricated it again and made it better than it was before. Well, they fixed the cracked or bent one and said if one cracks, the other one probably will too. So she built two of those. It was so exotic. It took most of the afternoon. But we learned a lot because we looked over her shoulder at her welding booth and we went through the whole process. It was a great learning process. And that gorgeous young lady handed Rob Holland two better than new rudder pedals for the airplane he will be flying today. And of course, they are the strongest thing on the airplane other than the pilot, Rob Holland.
It was so amazing to have been down at Muncie, Indiana when it was broken and they had just made the decision to fly up and see you guys up there. I thought, oh, how amazing is it that a lady with such talent outside our industry is just as indispensable in our industry.
Exactly. Now you see the rest of the team members out in the grassy area. Give them a wave and a big round of applause. They will be under canopy later on today for their full show. All six of them. Three are from Michigan, one is from Pennsylvania, one is from Park City, Utah, and one is from Phoenix, Arizona. They are six of the 10 members of the team, and yes, the team has some history. They have been around 30 years now, with various team members rotating in and out. Joining the team from Phoenix is the former team owner and team leader, Cindy Irish. She is acting as assistant team leader today. And why do they call them the Misty Blues? Well, you see the hot pink and blue, and it will be presented with their legged banners that they have. Very shiny and rippling leg banners to depict their descent in the sky. And a special surprise for you. We'll show you what it is later. It's kind of for the kids, to enjoy. That'll be in their second or full show this afternoon. So we are happy to have the much in demand Misty Blues here, and they are presented by Rumpke Waste and Recycling, a longtime sponsor of this event, helping to keep your
ever since men and women have walked on the earth, they've dreamed of flying. They wonder what the birds could see that they could not. Even 500 years ago, artist and inventor Leonardo da Vinci dreamed of flight and made drawings of a flying machine. But it wasn't until 1903 1893 that two brothers from Dayton, Ohio, Wilbur and Orville Wright, built a powered airplane and overcame gravity and taught the world to fly. Show presented by Kroger will present the T-50 trainer competition aircraft, the B-25, 75th anniversary of the Doolittle Raid commemoration, the Misty Blues all-woman skydiving team. From New York, we've got the Geico Skytypers. World champion freestyle pilot Rob Holland will astound you with his MXS. We've got the United States Air Force's F-35 Lightning II and the Heritage Flight. All the way from Salinas, California, Sean D. Tucker will be with you in the Oracle Challenger 3. From down in Cincinnati, a couple of guys named Redline, and of course we have the F-A-18 Super Hornet. All of that and more as we celebrate freedom, we commemorate our history, and we aviate. Ladies and gentlemen, look to the sky. The 2017 Veteran Dayton Air Show presented by Kroger is about to start right now.
Hello, everybody. I'm Rob Ryder.
And I'm Danny Clisham. We are so happy to be here with you. The jumper is away. The jumper is Amanda Sheffield, the team leader of the much sought after Misty Blues all-female skydiving team. There are the official team colors popping out at 3,500 feet and deploying that canopy almost immediately. Hot pink and navy blue, the colors of the team. Now very soon, you will see Amanda Sheffler, headquartered in Ann Arbor, Michigan, unfurl that flag as it now will fill up the blue Dayton sky. Get a load of this now again from that altitude. Look at the size of the flag in relation to the canopy. As it gets closer, you will appreciate that 1,800 square feet of LeMay rippling by design to give it more animation. Waiting for her cue to sing our national anthem live and in person. Master Sergeant Allison Jones in full uniform. What a glorious sight. What an outstanding location for a show. All roads lead to Dayton, Ohio. Picking out the cardinal altitudes now. 2,500, 1,000 feet has been lost. What you get from that large American flag is actually some lifting power. It helps at times to keep the parachute in the air. You might think it's a lot of weight and a lot of drag, but you actually get what they call hang time. So, ladies and gentlemen, if you will, please join us in standing as Master Sergeant Allison Jones presents our national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. Still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave?
RV8s. RV, not for recreational vehicle, although they are very recreational. They are named after the designer of the airplane, Richard Van Grunsven. That guy has come up with a design that has become the most popular home-built design in the history of aviation, with over 10,000 of these airplanes flying. As a matter of fact, Ken and John built these airplanes themselves. Between them, they have built 16 of these airplanes. Now watch, this is the line abreast loop. Ken Reeder outbound, outboard, John Thacker inboard, looking directly off to his right to maintain position. This is just a short bit of what you will see in their full-up presentation later on today. Now, the nose has come up. Ken Reeder, the leader, flies for PSA Airlines. John Thacker has a business outside of air shows where he does avionics upgrades for experimental aircraft. And boy, does he do a good job. That company is called Redline. He's got a 25-year history flying with DHL, and he helped Ken Reeder get a job at DHL too. And they asked if they'd ever flown together. He told the people in the interview, yes, they had, but never in the same airplane, only in formation together. Now, let's watch as they come in from the left. Get your cameras on this as we see the flip and the flop. Watch the half rolls all the way down the line. Ladies and gentlemen of Vandalia, let's give these guys a big round of applause. Ken and John, Redline. Half Cuban 8 into the upright position. Ken Reeder in the outboard in the lead, and John now chasing him. This is the tail chase. Let's watch him as they come over the top into this incredibly beautiful blue sky at Dayton, Ohio, at the Dayton International Airport. Oh my goodness, I love the way this looks. These airplanes are some of the most economical planes you could ever want. And one of the Misty Blues, Cindy Irish, has an airplane very similar to this, and she knows what I'm talking about. These airplanes literally get about 24 miles to the gallon. They are so inexpensive and economical to operate, and they are a boatload of fun to fly. Coming through now at 200 miles per hour, watch the triple roll from Ken Reeder and the four-point roll by John Thacker. They will be back later, ladies and gentlemen. Let's give you one big round of applause one more time for Redline. Oh, we've got much more coming. On behalf of the entire Vectren family, we want to welcome you to the 2017 Vectren Dayton Air Show presented by Kroger. With natural gas prices at historic lows, Vectren reminds you to consider all the benefits of using clean, safe, and reliable natural gas in your home or business. Vectren, live smart. Danny Clisham, what a great start as they come back through in the mirror image pass. Upside down is Ken Reeder, and right side up is John Thacker. And Ken Reeder is still doing the lead right there. And they're going to set up for their landing on runway 24 right. And we've got more happening today than I ever would have believed, Danny Clisham. We're talking about aerobatic airplanes that can do just about anything here.
And we're going to change the pace a little bit to the world of competition as we introduce you to a man who is debuting here, a guy who's flying, who has been flying all his life courtesy of lessons from his father, and over the years has been very much involved in the steps of competition aerobatics. He has gotten to the point now where he is going to be representing the United States of America in the International Olympics of the Sky.
This takes place every other year at a different host country. The host country this year is South Africa. Each country that participates is allowed only 10 flying crew members. We are going to send 8 pilots to that competition, hoping to bring home the gold medals. And the man I'm talking about that will be doing that is Bob Freeman. His company is called Free Man Air Shows Limited, as in the freedom of the sky. Now, he's flying an airplane that you might have seen in its previous life, flying the Red Bull Air Races. It has been reconfigured for Bob Freeman. And they're sponsored by our good friends at Suzuki. And as you've been walking around today, and as you walk around throughout the remainder of the day, you will see a big Suzuki transporter right out in the middle of the spectator area, and they have a display unparalleled of all of their great equipment for you to enjoy, to ask questions about. They have people that will answer your questions, and they are on page number 35 of your program. So thank you, Suzuki, for bringing here. Stop by the Suzuki trailer, the transporter, and you can say hi to Bob Freeman after he flies this routine. Coming up through the lower categories of competition, then going to advanced, which is one step below unlimited, or the most difficult method of competition. Hoping to bring home the gold, bronze, and silver to the U.S. All right, now Bob Freeman is from Lyons, Colorado. He'll be going up to an altitude between 3,500 and 4,000 feet of altitude. He will start his dive in, and he will be looking for speed between 248 miles an hour and 260 miles per hour. Then it will be lightning fast, precise maneuvers, because you see, in International Olympic Competition of the Year, you must impress the judges. They are the ones on the ground that are going to score you. And you want to do a perfect flight. You want to be imaginative. You want to be precise. You want to be on time. And you want to get the most maneuvers you can out of a given flight. Now, they will hand you a card that you must fly. A maneuver card that you must fly, that's called a compulsory. You'll also be able to do a 4-minute freestyle. And there will be other flights as well. But unless you impress that international group of judges on the ground, you are not going to get the gold. To get where Bob Freeman is in the air today, it is a grueling amount of work. These flights are punishing flights because of the world of gravity. High G loads that force you down into your seat or try to pull you away from your seat. It takes a tremendous amount of physical endurance as well as mental concentration. And you're going to see these lightning fast maneuvers. How so many maneuvers are combined into one, and you can thank Suzuki for bringing Bob Freeman and his Free Man Air Shows Limited to Lyons, Colorado. You also have to choose the correct airplane. You've got to have an airplane that can bring the gold home to you, and a pilot combination to be able to utilize the best features of an aircraft. So they are very expensive. They are very light. They are very strong. And they, I'm proud to say, are most often, as Bob comes in from your right, most often powered by an American-built Lycoming engine. So this is the triple lightning rotor. You can see that rate of roll, 400 degrees per second. That's what it takes. Now, let's start spinning that airplane on the way up, Bob. There's one. There's two rolls on the way up. Pulls it up into the blue. Now watch this. He's going to lay it off on his side. It's going to stop. Then he'll put it into what we call the knife edge environment and spin the airplane down on the side of the fuselage. And that is a wild ride. Would you give Bob Freeman a big round of applause now? He will be representing the United States of America. And he is the guy to do it. By the way, two members of the team will be flying for you today. Later on, Rob Holland, who will also be on that team, will be flying for you. But now it's Bob Freeman.
and it is Suzuki. As they do a turnaround called the Alien Turnaround. Now you're also working for the judges in a specific area known as the box. You can't have an excursion out the left or right. Watch Freeman now as he tumbles the airplane out of that half loop and then controls the airplane again on the down run. The next maneuver will be a hairpin turnaround. And again, you can't have an excursion out the left side of that invisible boundary. You can't get too low, you can't get too high, you can't get too close, and you can't get too far. It is just a little arena to operate in. There is the hairpin turnaround with rolls on the down line. Now it's time for Bob Freeman to get red in the face as he rolls upside down, flies the aircraft inverted, the blood goes to his head. Then pulling back on the stick, he will bleed off all of the speed. And this we call the chiropractor. It is a whip stall that helps take all the kinks out of your back. A big round of applause for Bob Freeman as he will represent the United States of America. Brought to you this weekend by Suzuki. Now, you know, at Kroger we can always pick up a nice dessert like a cake. Bob Freeman, I'm just gonna put a little cake in the sky for you. You know that cake is great, Rob, if you have some frosting on it, you know, like a birthday cake. So you watch as Bob goes to the vertical and gets ready to bake that cake for you. Rolling the aircraft around, now he is slicing the horizon at 90 degrees, using the wingtips to do that with a view of the left and right side of the canopy. Going invisible to his magic act, torquing down through his smoke on the descending line and then recovering. All right, the cake is gonna be made in the sky. Now look, give me a little icing on that cake. As Bob comes around now, descending on the 45 degree line from upside down to right side up. Watch as he gets upside down, picks out the blue. Right about in here, there's some icing on the cake. One, two, squigglies up there. So that's your Kroger cake in the sky. Now, from the cake, he's going to take the right aileron and right rudder and stuff it all in the right side of the airplane. That will make the airplane do this. Go gyroscope. Using the power of the engine, the efficiency and the torque of the engine, and a high-tech propeller to gyro the aircraft around. Now, we're going to go into a thing we see in sports, and that's slow motion. Bob Freeman is going to do the super slow motion roll and then speed it up almost instantly to its 400 degrees per second. There's slow, there's fast, as promised. Now, 5/8 of a looping maneuver as Bob again makes his reference off the left and right side of the airplane. He'll be setting up on the descending line, picking up altitude and speed for the entry of the next maneuver, which will be a spiraling tilt. Again, stuffing the controls into one side of the airplane. Still going up and rotating. Then a spin on the descending line. Remember, you are the judge. Just like judges are going to be scoring each one of these maneuvers for symmetry, for flow, for precision. This maneuver is called the separator. As it separates the winners from the has-beens. Straight up now for a maneuver known as the hammerhead turnaround. On the way up, we see the full plan view of the wings and a peek inside of Bob's office. On the descending line, he's going to have to make an adjustment to get back in the air show line and again impress you, the judges. Next, he'll be setting up for the Immelmann turn with a series of snap rolls rolls, hesitation rolls, and point rolls. There's the emblem, one half of a roll. Now snaps the airplane in a knife edge flight. Now rolls it in the opposite direction. Now stops it upside down. Now rolls it from upside down to upside down, bringing the stick back in his lap, wasting no distance and no time. Inverted flight, gear up towards the sky. Remember, Bob will be at the Suzuki transporter trailer located in your spectator area, where you can pick out your favorite Suzuki machine and meet Bob Freeman. And congratulate him on his birth on the team. Only 8 pilots will go. This is one of the 8. Okay, straight up now. The vertical roll once again. Reference is out the left and right side of the cockpit. You know that. Across the top, we call that the hairpin turnaround. Now, a half roll to change direction, to go from left to right. Watch this, watch the nose and the tail as it will swap ends, end over end. Start in a precision manner, end in a precision manner. That's the mark of a champion. And inside the cockpit, much like anybody competing in a triathlon, Bob Freeman is short of breath. This is grueling work. As you take the punishment of the high G loads, always 2 to 3 maneuvers ahead in your mind of where you are and where the airplane is, knowing that you must have the speed, the altitude, and the distance to get the next maneuver done, lest you be penalized by the scrutiny of the judges. The ability to go vertical, to defy gravity a long period of time, is the mark of a championship airplane. This is the Suzuki Extra monoplane. We call this maneuver the goldfish. First the slider in knife edge flight. Leading off all the speed now, he will transition into the flop maneuver of the goldfish. As you can see, the smoke bunching up, meaning minimum speed and then the roll on the descending line. For Bob Freeman now to go to knife edge flight, to knife edge flight. Roll it around to knife edge flight. Roll it around one more to right side up. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is a man you have to meet today. Where do you see him? Let him land, let him taxi back, let him get a breath of fresh air, and then meet him over at the Suzuki Transporter. They are a full lineup of great Suzuki personnel, including some of our great pilot friends who answer all the questions you have about their products. You can meet Bob Freeman, congratulate him for representing the United States of America, being one of 8 that will hope to bring home the gold. You'll meet the other one of 8 later on today. That will be Rob Holland. That will be coming up very soon.
Welcome, air show fans. The Kroger Company is proud to present the 2017 Veteran Dayton Air Show. You'll be awestruck, as you have been already, by the demonstrations and displays of skill and precision. To veterans and active duty personnel who are here today, who serve and protect our country, we thank you for
involved. That means jobs.
aerospace industry as they hope to sell or manufacture about 350 of these and perhaps up to 1,000 worldwide during the course of the program.
With over 145,000 hours already demonstrated on the Korean version, the Golden Eagle T-50, this one, it may be the one that wins. What has gone on is that with the Texan 2, which is a turboprop airplane, that's a trainer with a propeller that's turned by a jet engine, as the pilots are transitioning to the F-22 Raptor and also to the F-35 Lightning II, they need a higher performance trainer. And so this may be the one. Let's watch as the T-50 comes in from the right and demonstrates its capabilities here at the Veteran Dayton Air Show presented by Kroger. To be with the F-16 Fighting Falcon demonstration team is part of the team that is working on this T-50 as it competes for this contract for the next generation, or maybe you want to call it the fifth generation trainer for the Air Force. Its ability to fly supersonic on one engine, very, very important. But the economy is also very, very important, and its durability has to be extremely important, as well as the avionics that are inside the cockpit, that suite of aviation electronics that will help train the pilots as they transition to the incredibly capable and complex weapons and navigation and targeting systems that are in the F-35 Lightning II. Danny?
The mandate for whoever is awarded the contract will fulfill several basic training roles: basic aircraft control, airmanship, formation instrumentation, navigation, advanced air-to-air, advanced air-to-ground, advanced crew cockpit resource management, and using the simulator, Rob, they will also learn in the simulator air-to-air refueling, although it will not be done in this aircraft. Slow speed capability, and by the way, high G requirements in this program to be able to withstand. All right, fast jet competition, folks. You keep your eyes on the news and on the trades and see which one of these companies in the future is going to be awarded this contract as we turn it back over to Rob Ryder.
Yeah, and I will just say that this, again, points to the importance of Dayton, Ohio in the aerospace future of America. Dayton, Ohio is still the hub. Coming up in just a moment, world freestyle aerobatic champion Rob Holland will be here with us. Stephen Fiegel will take over in just a minute, but we want to thank the folks from Kettering Medical College. If healthcare is your calling, Kettering College is the place for you. With around 800 students, Kettering College's programs include online competition degrees, associates of science degrees, bachelor's degrees, a master's degree.
This is on my heart. I dedicate this heart to each and every one of you.
Thank you, Rob. High into your right, diving in and reaching speeds in excess of 300 miles per hour. Check out the incredible roll rate of the Nano Pro MT MXS. Now more than 9G shoving Rob into the cockpit. He continues with a series of vertical rolls to set up for his rolling spin. Look high into your left. Rap Rolling Spin, this is the only person in the world you'll see do this. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you do not want to miss this next maneuver. Another Rob Holland original, and one of his favorites. This is the Inside Tumble. Ladies and gentlemen. Rob Holland has won championship on both national and international level. He is the six-time defending U.S. national aerobatic champion, a seven-time U.S. freestyle aerobatic champion, three-time defending world freestyle aerobatic champion, and the 2008 world advanced aerobatic champion. As you watch some of his competition videos, you'll see they're all rigorous precision and flawless presentation. Rob works incredibly hard to show his competition flying skills and is reflected in his crisp and very precise flying style. We'd like to take a moment to thank all of our marketing partners for the 2017 season. They are MTL Avionics, Dream Scheme Designs, Boomba, Sky Dynamics, Whirlwind Propellers, Tubro Aviation, Vidal HD Sunglasses, Nano Pro MT, and of course, MX Aircraft. If you'd like to share your pictures or experiences from today's show, follow us on Facebook at @ultimateairshows, or Twitter or Instagram at @RobHolland5150. Now, earlier today, you saw the right side up for the men and women and volunteers who spent countless hours putting this awesome air show group together for you this weekend. Also, our sponsor, NanoPro MT, not only produces high-performance products for military helicopters like the Apache and the Black Hawk, but they also make products you can use in your car. They're carried at AutoZones all across the country. Look high to your left as Rob dives in for his next maneuver. This is also his newest maneuver. It's an inside tumble. It's an outside tumble. And he's going to finish it off giving you an awesome view of the NanoPro FT MXS. At almost zero. This next pass is going to be a great opportunity to get an awesome shot of the NanoPro MT MXS. Low and from your left, first Rob's going to show you the top. And now the bottom. And for those of you who missed it, just in case, very quickly. Now look high into your left as Rob sets up for, excuse me, high into your right as Rob sets up for his landing. Normally a pilot looks very, very stable approach to landing. I think we can all agree after today's performance, Rob is not a normal pilot. So he's going to throw in a flat spin on final. He's going to have to wait for his landing clearance, so he's going to hover out there and give you one more good look at the NanoPro MT MXS. Now, ladies and gentlemen, Rob's been working very hard, so keep an eye on him as he slides down to the runway, because he's tired and he does occasionally bounce a landing. Oh, he didn't roll on landing. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for watching. That's Rob, I'm Steve, and we are Rob Holland Ultimate Air Shows. Enjoy the rest of this awesome air show. Back to you, Danny.
Thank you, Steve. Beagle, give Steve a big round of applause putting you in the cockpit. Wow. And he continues to support the Air Force through this service.
on the Air Force Museum Foundation Board of Trustees and serves as a volunteer at the museum. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome retired Brigadier General Paul A. Cooper, U.S. Air Force. Next, on May of 2004, inducted into the Ohio Military Hall of Fame for valor. He is a recipient of the Distinguished Flying Cross for Heroism and Vietnam Service Medal with 3 Bronze Stars. Please recognize retired Chief Warrant Officer, United States Army, James E. Miller. This next American hero, despite 7 years and 8 months as a Vietnam prisoner of war, gave his captors nothing more than his name, rank, and serial number, and date of birth. Please welcome retired Lieutenant Colonel Paul R. Carey, United States Air Force. And collectively, let's all please pay tribute to these true American heroes and welcome them to this, the Veteran Date Near Show presented by Kroger. Gentlemen, thank you so much. We honor you, we love you, and we couldn't do it without you. And thank you to the Ford Motor Company, Rob Wright.
Yes, indeed. We sure appreciate all they have done. This is a year of celebration, of commemoration, and this is a show to do all that and aviate as well. And Danny, I know you're going to take over again on this next part of the show, but I want everybody to look out to the right just to take a look at this. The first twin-engine aircraft ever built by North American Aviation. It was so important to the war in every theater of the war, and yet it is best known for one very, very special event. Danny Klischem.
And that event occurred in April 75 years ago. We are commemorating that this year. And it was the Jimmy Doolittle raid on Tokyo. Departing from the decks of an aircraft carrier, fully laden with fuel, with bombs, with crew members, it did the impossible on what many thought would be a suicide mission. The B-25 is low and to your right. It is one of only about 45 that can actually fly. Almost 10,000 were built. This one comes to us from the Champaign Aviation Museum. B-25, known as Champaign Gal, from Urbana, Ohio. Pilots are Eric Kindig and Bill Weidenheimer. Through this tease maneuver, we will replicate what happened over the enemy territory back in that era. Now, taking off this aircraft from the deck of an aircraft carrier was a major event, because they actually forced the airplane into the air some 40 knots, less than the speed you need to have the rudders effective. Now, what does that mean to you and I? Had they lost an engine on takeoff off the deck of the carrier, or one engine failed to produce 100% power, the rudders would not allow them to go straight. They would have either hit the superstructure and exploded, or have flown off the side and be lost in the ocean. That made it even more difficult. The pilots trained under secrecy outside of Eglin Air Force Base in Florida. The aircraft were then flown cross-country. In Alameda, California, they were loaded on board ship. It was a top-secret mission. And again, you can learn more about this through the movie or the book, 30 Seconds Over Tokyo. We are honoring those as they popped up over the major cities and the enemy's territory. You see the Emperor
laws had told their people in the Pacific, you will never be molested on our shores. You will never see the enemy over our home territory. Doolittle proved that to be false. The enemy had to change their seaborne tactics, and when they did that, the war for them was beginning to be lost. Folks, prior to that time, you know that we had lost a lot of people at Pearl Harbor. Many of you have been there. Many of you have seen the documentaries. You know of the horrific time that those who lived and those who died had there. Well, we were down in the dumps. Morale in America was low. People just didn't have the spirit that they should. But when Doolittle and the Raiders successfully made their way to the target, things changed rapidly. Morale went up to an all-time high, and we started to win. Because they were forced to leave the aircraft carrier hundreds of miles sooner than they thought, being spotted by a Japanese fishing trawler that they were sure radioed their position. Many of them knew that they would have to ditch in the ocean, run out of gas, or crash land. And many of them did, as you watch those movies we talked about. All right, get your eyes and cameras ready. You know where the gasoline and dynamite is. Get your cameras so that you get a little bit of grass at the bottom of your shot, but mostly sky and clouds, because that's where the flames are going to go. This will be the wall of fire from the Tora 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 bomb crew, led by second generation pyro expert Ben West. On the target area that I mentioned to you. And you can feel the heat. Ladies and gentlemen, many of you are standing. Will you remain standing with us, please? If you're healthy enough, at this point in time, to the greatest generation, and to all of the men and women who have kept us free over the years and kept us from tyranny, would you join me, please, in several seconds of silence? So much. Please, if you want to, please, if you will, be seated. Again, a big round of applause, if you will. These are the men and women that made it happen. The guys that flew the airplane, the women that ferried the airplane into the combat zones, and Rosie the Riveter, who went to the factories from states like Ohio, Kentucky, Tennessee, Michigan, to build at very high production rates these war machines. They built the ships, they built the guns, they built the tanks, they built airplane after airplane after airplane, hence the term Rosie the Riveter. They are to be commended. They are from the greatest generation, and we are very fortunate to have them.
Thank you, Danny Clisham. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause, if you will, not only for the B-25 demonstration and crew and the Tora bomb squad, but Danny Clisham and his description of the air raid against which all other air missions have been compared. Thanks, Danny. The Veteran Dayton Air Show, presented by Kroger, continues, and in just a moment, we'll be putting another World War II airplane into the sky. another aircraft built by North American Aviation. Now, the B-25 that came by, we got to hear it every time it went by with those big Wright Cyclone engines, each of which generating about 1,700 horsepower. And Danny, I'm not sure if you mentioned it today. I know you mentioned it yesterday about those short exhaust stacks and the kind of noise it made.
Well, it was a staccato, they called it, popping sound. They had no muffler system on it. And the Wright engine is very identifiable to your ears based on that sound, that short stacks. And by the way, it caused a lot of problems. You can always tell a guy that had a lot of time in a B-25, he not only had one hearing aid, he had two, because that noise, they didn't know about the noise back in those days, about noise-canceling headsets, and it ruined the hearing of a lot of the pilots, especially the guys who flew it in missions fighting fires or in movie photo work throughout the course of the years. They just learned that sound will damage your ears.
Indeed, with the propeller tips actually coming within about 20 inches of the window next to the pilot and co-pilot.
And remember again, I'll remind you, that movie is available on all those channels that you and I get. 30 Seconds Over Tokyo, starring Spencer Tracy as Jimmy Doolittle.